Hi, this is Shijie from Tidal Robotics. In this video, you will learn how to interface a CAN ESC with our flight stand software. This process is broken down into simple steps that you can follow along using the same hardware that we have here. Once you complete this walkthrough, you should be able to follow the same process with any other third-party hardware. At the end of this tutorial, you should be able to control this ESC from the manual control tab in our software and see the real-time telemetry data. If you don't have this hardware yet, you can still follow part one of this guide. Here is a list of the items you will need to purchase. You can find a link in the description of this video. You will need two USB to micro B cables, as well as a Zubax Babel USB to CAN adapter. You will also need a JST 4-pin cable and a UAV propulsion kit from Zubax. The propulsion kit includes a propeller, a motor, and an ESC. You will also need a UAV CAN termination resistor and an external power supply for the ESC that can power up to 15 volts. Starting with part one of this video, the software setup. In part one, we will install the flight stand software, download the API libraries and code examples, set up PyCharm virtual environments and libraries, set up the UConn SIFL software, and run example 1, a simulated SIFL device. You will not need any of the hardware listed earlier to follow along with part 1 of this tutorial. We'll get started with part 1, downloading the flight stand software. Go to tidalrobotics.com, software, flight stand software, and download now. Once the setup file downloads, go to your downloads folder and open it. Hit run. You should see the installation box pop up, and after it's finished, it should launch the software automatically. This confirms the software is downloaded and working correctly. Next, we'll download the GitLab repository. Go to gitlab.com/tidalrobotics/flightstand-api. Hit download and download the entire repository as a zip folder. Then open your downloads folder and extract the entire repository into where it makes sense for you. For us, we'll simply extract it onto our desktop folder. As you can see, all the required files are now in our desktop. Next, we'll go to the JetBrains website and download PyCharm. We want to download the PyCharm Community Edition. This is an open source software development IDE. Once it's finished downloading, open it and simply follow the instructions to go through the setup process. We do not need to change any of the default settings during the setup. Once PyCharm has finished downloading, we can simply hit finish. Next, we will download the latest version of Python. Go to python.org, downloads, latest version, and download the recommended version. Once the file has downloaded, again, we can open it from File Explorer. We will run through the recommended installation settings, and once complete, we will open PyCharm. Accept the terms and conditions. Then we want to open the repository that we downloaded earlier. For us, it's in our desktop folder. Click on Trust Project, and you'll see the repository come up in the File Explorer on the left. In the folder that we downloaded, if you go to Languages, Python, Examples, and canbus_sifl, this is where you'll find all of the examples that we'll be running in today's tutorial. Before going any further, we'll first configure our Python interpreter. Go to Settings, Project, Python Interpreter, and hit Add Interpreter. We want to create a new environment, and we'll want to check that the file path is set to the Flight Stand API folder. Hit OK and Apply. PyCharm will then automatically set up the virtual environment. To confirm we have the virtual environment set up correctly, you can either hover over the bottom right to see it in the virtual environment path, or we can open a terminal and you can see the virtual environment come up before the command line. We'll go to the README file in examples. Read through this file for detailed instructions on how to get set up with the Python API with our flight stand software. In our tutorial, we'll simply run the three commands listed in the README. They'll install the proper packages in order for you to run the Python API. Assuming you have the console in the correct directory, you should be able to run the second command. The third command simply executes the simulated hardware.py file. You can check that this is working by going to our flight stand software and checking to see that a simulated board has been connected and an ESC throttle was inputted. Next, open the canvas sifo folder and open the README there. Here you'll see the steps you need to take to get set up for the canvas sifo software. You can see that example 1 here is designed to work without any external hardware. It creates a simulated sifo device and it interfaces it with our flight stand software. Let's get started with example 1. Open example 1 main, and you'll see the step-by-step instructions in the comments. We will need to install an additional package to run this example, but we can simply copy and paste this line from the code into the console, then hit enter. Once the package finishes installing, we will need to set up the run configuration of the file. Simply copy the environment variables here, then right-click and hit Modify Run Configuration. In the Environment Variables line, hit Ctrl-A, then Ctrl-V to replace the variables. Hit OK, then right-click and hit Run Example 1 Main. You can see that here, an error has been triggered. You need a license key for our flight stand software to be able to connect it with any external hardware. You can simply email the support@tidalrobotics.com email to request a free license key. Once you've received the license key, you can simply open our flight stand software, hit license, and copy and paste in the license key provided to you. Paste the key in, then hit enter. You should see the flight stand software restart, and once you check the license key tab, you can see that the license has been activated. You can now run the file again in PyCharm. When you check the flight stand software, you should see that it's connected a simulated heater. Next, it says to go to example1_plant. We'll follow the same steps, copying the environment variables, these are different from the first file, into the runtime configuration, and hit run. You can see that the heater is now receiving a temperature and voltage value. If you go to our flight stand software, you can see that we can now change the heater voltage to change the room temperature. If the simulated heater is working without issue, then you should have set up everything correctly up to this point. We have now completed step 3 and part 1. Next, we'll set up the UConn software. It's not a software developed by Tidal Robotics, and it's to help you interact with the sifo canvas devices. To download the software, we'll go to github.com/opensifo/UConn, then scroll down to GitHub releases. We'll click on the link, then click the UConn.exe download file. Once the file downloads, we can open it from our downloads folder. Next, we'll set up the DSDL namespace. This is something that's required to understand the type of data being communicated in the software. Hit Add Path, Browse, then navigate to the Flight Stand API, Languages, Python, Examples, Canvas, Sifo, then hit Public Regulated Data Types. We'll hit Add Path again, navigate to the same subfolder, except this time we want to select the Zubax DSDL folder. Scroll down to the end and hit Save Configuration. Then we'll close and restart the sifo software. The Zubax DSDL files are specific to Zubax Cypher CAN devices, and other manufacturers may have other DSDL files that you will need to import. Once UConn restarts, we'll change the UDP interface in the top right to be 127.0.0.1. Hit Run this transport. If you run into this error, cannot find wcap.dll library, you will need to download the npcap software from npcap.com. Scroll down and hit the npcap installer, then simply just run through the installation process. Once the installation is complete, go back to UConn, and you should be able to run the transport correctly. Make sure you only have example plant running. Then in UConn, we should be able to set it up to interface with the simulated heater in the flight stand software. Right-click on the line next to 2346 under temperature measurement. Hit subscribe, then hit subscribe again. This allows us to see the simulated temperature in real time. Do the same for line 2347, but hit publish instead. Click on add number field, then enter in volts. We can set the voltage to 5, then click enable. And you'll see the Kelvin temperature measurement slowly start to increase. Next, we'll go on to part 2, which is simply setting up the hardware and connecting it to the UConn software. Assuming your hardware works correctly, it should be a fairly simple process of setting it up. As you can see, we have two USB cables. The top one simply provides power to the ESC, while the bottom one transfers the data to the Zubax Babel device. You need to make sure the previous two examples are not running, so terminate the two consoles. We'll open example 3. You can follow the instructions in the comments of this file. Step 1 is to connect all the hardware to our PC. We've already done that. So the next step is to open UConn and make sure the hardware is set up correctly in UConn. First, we'll go to settings and make sure that we have all the DSDL files we need. In particular, the Zubax DSDL is important. This ESC will not work without the Zubax DSDL files. We'll navigate to CAN and SLCAN on the right side. We'll make sure that it's COM3, then start the transport. Next, we want to add the physics.dynamics to port 100, the physics.electric to port 101, and the Zubax torque set point to port 111. We'll restart the connection. You can also go see the registers for the ESC. In our case, we purchased our ESC pre-configured, so we do not need to change any values. However, you can see that the PID coefficients are all zeros. Therefore, if you'd like to experiment with further control, you would have to set up your own values. In the Monitor tab, we want to subscribe to port 101 and 100. This allows us to take voltage, current, and RPM readings from the ESC. We'll publish to port 111, which means that we can control our ESC via torque. We'll put a small torque value of 0.05 Nm, and when we enable, you can see that our ESC causes our motor to spin up to maximum speed relatively quickly. This is because there is no load on the motor, thus the torque will never reach the value that we inputted. Next, we'll go to part 3, which is linking the hardware and software. We'll run the Canvas ESC example, and we'll interact with the ESC from the flight stand software. So on the example 3 Telega ESC file, we'll set up the runtime environment by copy and pasting the runtime variables into the configuration. We'll change the port to COM3, as this is the port that the ESC is connected to. Then we'll copy and paste into the configuration. We'll make sure that we have the flight stand software open. Then we'll run example 3. If you see the running message, And in the flight stand software, you can see the Zubax ESC. Then you've set up everything correctly. We can now change the hardware mappings, or we can simply just run the ESC. To do so, we'll simply enable manual control of the ESC, then activate it at some arbitrary value. As you can see, the ESC sends a command to the motor to spin up to the torque value that we put. Changing the torque value will not make the motor spin faster or slower, as there's no load. That's all you need to do to connect a CAN bus device to our flight stand software. Keep in mind that this process can be adapted to any type of third-party hardware, even if it's not CAN bus. As long as you communicate with your hardware from Python, you can link it to the flight stand software using our example as inspiration. If you need any more help, feel free to reach out to our support. Thanks for watching.